So what I was handing out is the same handout that I used last week on Wednesday, and it is in the PowerPoint. So I just was handing out the extras in case people wanted them, but it's not different. It's identical to what's in the PowerPoint. So if you missed it and you didn't get the handout in the last lecture, you should watch the webcast of the lecture, or it will do you no good at all. I think getting that handout and you think, wait a minute, I thought this course was fun and it was about nice, interesting things like gender and sex, and then there are these tables, oh God. So, you know, it won't do you any good if you don't look at the lecture. Okay, now, just to say the practical things about the exam, which is, I said all this in an email, but I have confidence that you, like me, get so many emails that you often delete them without looking at them or don't read them all the way to the bottom. So the first point is that it really is a 50-minute exam in which every minute is going to matter. That is, you've got a lot of writing to do. And so it will really pay to get here early and get yourselves settled so that the exam can actually start at 10 minutes after the hour. The second thing is that when you come in, I'm going to ask you to sit every other seat. And then people who come in later will fill in between the people who are already seated. But I want to arrange it so that ideally you are not sitting next to your best friend. We probably are going to fill every seat. So a third weird thing I'm going to ask of you is to not leave the exam even if you finish early. I want everyone to stay in his or her seat. If you are on an aisle seat and you can leave without anyone else being disturbed, or you're in a front row here, not up there, and no one has to shift his or her paper, and you finish early, which would mean you didn't really know anything, it's okay, but otherwise I want everyone else, so you've got to go to the bathroom or whatever you need to do before you come to class so that you can sit still for 50 minutes. The third thing, I've said this, but you've got to bring a large blue book, just the normal, there are two sizes, basically large and small. Bring a large one, and if you haven't bought it yet, you might as well buy three because you will need two for the final. In this course. I don't know if you have to get a blue book for other courses, but this is a useful thing to have around. And again, don't write your name on it. Don't write anything in it because you're going to hand it in and we will hand you one. Okay. And then about the format of the exam, I still haven't written it, which allows me to answer your questions during the review session in a little more relaxed way. I don't have to panic if you ask me the identical question to what I'm asking you. But just to say, the first thing is I do not ask trick questions. I do not ask questions about tiny little details meant to hang you up on some trivial part of the reading you didn't notice. And I always give you the name of the author and the title of a reading, or I tell you if the question refers to something from lecture. So this is a situation where I want you to be able to show what you know, not where I want to trip you up, where you actually know it, but you can't figure out how the question is asking you to show what you know. So I try to make it as straightforward in that way as I can. So if I were to put, you know, a type of suicide, I would put parentheses Durkheim, right? So I try to remind you so you don't have to memorize these authors' names or anything like that. I don't care if you can spell Acemoglu, which you can't unless you're Turkish, okay, which he is. And the other thing is that it will certainly be a set of four or five or six short answer questions in the first half and either one or two essay questions. The short answer questions are either a one-sentence thing that might say, list three ways that X happens, or list or define and give the significance of X. And that means write three or four lines. It does not mean write a whole long essay because you do not have time. And I tell you how many minutes each question should take you, and that is how many points the question is worth. So if it's a 5-minute short answer, it will count 10 points out of 100 on the final. If it's a 25-minute essay, it's going to count 50 points. So the real piece of wisdom here is allocate your time well. Do not get caught up in writing an incredibly, you know, a 15-minute answer to a 5-minute essay and then be stuck with 10 minutes to write your final essay. That's crazy. And again, I'm going to have either 4, 5, or 6 short answers and either 1 essay or 2 essays. So I haven't decided whether to do it 20 minutes for the first part with 4 short answers and 2 15-minute essays, or 25 minutes for the first part with 5 short answers and 1 25-minute essay, but it'll be something between those two models. And the last thing is that you will definitely have a choice. So if I write short answer questions, I will write a couple more than you actually have to answer. If I have essays, I'll give you a choice of 2 out of 3 or 1 out of 2. So the idea is for those of you who have actually done the reading, gone to lecture, reviewed and thought about what you've learned, the exam won't be easy because it's still, there's not quite enough time to write everything you know. So it's not gonna be easy in that sense, but it will be straightforward. It will not have trick questions. The essay question will ask you to link 2 parts of the course that are not linked. So there's where you might have to think. That is, I mean, all of them, hopefully, if you've thought, you'll do better. But the essay would be, you know, what would author A say about author B's book, or what would the ideas from lecture lead you to think about the important points of this book? Something like that. So the essays link 2 things. The short answers are about 1 thing. And the 1 thing could be a thing from lecture, or the 1 thing could be a thing from reading. Okay. I think that is every practical thing I can tell you. And so now I am ready, and students who've actually done some review and can ask good questions will be beloved of the other students who are still walking around in a fog and beginning to panic, as you should. Okay, so I'm ready for questions. I said this in the email, that the review is not me telling you about the course. It's you asking me questions. So if there are things you're, yes. And what's your name?
Gabby.
Gabby. Oh, you're the other Gabby. Okay, great.
How much depth should you really understand
when you're going over the biological processes? How much depth should you know the stuff about methylation? Not, I mean, since I'm partly talking through my hat, no, I actually know of more than you'd think I would know because I'm part of a research group that works on that stuff. But I think if you understand the basic idea that even what is biological can be reshaped through social experience, all the way down to how the DNA expresses itself, you're fine. And you certainly don't have to be able to draw a molecule or anything like that. Yes? Your name?
Alex.
Alex, okay.
When you were mentioning the HPA axis and the was that evidence that there's some parts of our identity that is kind of ingrained, but because different social situations can change the way that things are expressed or how things develop, that it's also modular, so it's like a combination?
Okay, I see your question, and I wouldn't put it in exactly the words you have. So I'm going to restate the question. It was about what you were supposed to get out of my introducing the HPA axis, the serotonin system, and the prefrontal cortex. And yes, there were really 2 ideas there. One is the idea that aspects of the brain are modular. So you've got these different systems that evolved at different periods evolutionarily and that may not be very well connected to each other. There was also the idea that each of these systems is refashioned by your social experience. So they're biologically built in. So the, you know, HPA axis is this kind of primitive thing that regulates fear and responses to the world and stuff like that. And the serotonin system regulates basic capacities for attachment and sort of bonding to other people. And your prefrontal cortex regulates something about your ability to rationally integrate your behavior and be purposeful and make decisions and things like that. But yes, you might have different parts of you that are actually pulling in totally different directions, and that's because they literally are embedded in different sort of biological substrates, but also in child development. Each of those systems is the most malleable, the most reshapable at different ages. So the things that can in deep ways alter you psychologically are things that happen at different ages. And the one word I wouldn't have used in asking that question is identity, because I didn't use the word identity in that lecture. And identities, I think of at least, as much more socially grounded. They always have to do with a link between some way you define yourself in relationship to categories that the social world provides for you. I don't believe there's any such thing as having an identity that isn't a fundamentally interactional social fact, even if you experience your identity as very, very personal, because it's about you, it's not about the person next to you, but it is always, in my understanding of that term, an interactional thing. Okay, yes, your name?
I'm Paula.
Paula. Should you in the essay connect what you're learning to the real world? I would say basically no. Not unless, in the final, I sometimes ask a question like, if you were president, what would you do about poverty or something like that? And in that case, yes. But I think when you have relatively little time on an exam like this, you really do want to focus on the readings. And I will say that Your GSIs aren't wasting your time by getting you to connect the readings to the real world. They're trying to get you to really understand them, right? If you can't apply them, then you probably don't actually understand them. So I think you'll see that the thinking you did to apply it to the real world has helped you really understand the ideas, and that's extremely valuable. But no, for this exam, I would not go flying off in some, I will say, old people like me who've been reading exams for much longer than you'd ever want to know tend to see that as filler that people use when they don't know the answer. So, yes, and remind me your name?
Andy.
Andy, okay, I know you.
So all the readings have a lot of different components. How much have you studied, like, the concept?
Yeah. All the readings have a lot of examples. How much do you study the concepts in the readings versus the specifics? And I would say this is a very difficult problem. And I try, again, I will not ask you about the examples. So I won't say, when Acemoglu and Robinson discuss Sierra Leone, what's their point? I will not ask that question. But I might ask something about how Acemoglu and Robinson understand what an extractive state is and why. And if you can provide an example, so if they provided five examples and you don't remember all five, but you remember one of them, you'll be able to use it. So the answer is something that shows you actually did the reading, not just kind of vaguely listened to the discussion in section, will help you. But I will not ask questions that zero in on some detail that you probably that even a student who read the thing and is trying to remember it might not remember. Again, I don't like tricking people, so I want you to show what you know, but I don't want to ask a question that might lead even the student who was conscientious, studied hard, and knows a lot to mess up the question. I don't want to do that if I can help it. Sometimes, again, questions are bad. I wish it never happened. Emily. what is, she's asking, what is the cognitive developmental theory in general as opposed to the cognitive developmental theory of sex role socialization? Is that a fair, okay, and I guess it is the argument that many aspects of our identity depend on our attempt to find a place within the larger categories that we observe and that we experience as objective parts of the society we live in. So, rich, poor. Asian, African American, white. Educated, uneducated. Male, female. Married, not married. Now, some of these change, so in, you know, 50 years ago, 60 years ago, I'm not quite sure. Married, unmarried, for women, was every time someone addressed you. You were either Mrs. Jones or you were Ann Smith. And if you were Ann Smith, you were unmarried. And if you were Mrs. Jones, you were married. And so that category that differentiated married and unmarried women was, it wasn't something you said, oh, I really care a lot whether I'm married or not, and it matters, and I really want to wear that ring, and I wish I had a husband. It was that the world was categorized into married and unmarried. Now, that is much more ambiguous. You can sign every form on the planet with Ms., or in my case, I don't have my husband's name, but I am married. So people, I just made a plane reservation and that I didn't make it, it was made by the, you know, I'm going to give a lecture and they bought the ticket. And so they send me the thing and say, is this all correct? And I was all worried about whether they would misspell Swidler, Swindler, as is often done, but it was Mrs. Ann Swidler. Now, in fact, there is no such person. That is, there is just, I am Ann Swidler and I'm married, but I'm not married to someone named Swidler. So it just, there really isn't such a concept. But that's all by way of saying that the cognitive developmental theory is really about the way children come to understand the basic organization of the social world the same way they come to understand the basic organization of the objective world, so to speak. And he literally, I didn't say this in lecture, but he literally connects the development of these very basic identity categories to things like whether, which these are old Piaget, for those of you who know psychology, P-I-A-G-E-T, categories, like whether children can understand that the amount of water in a glass is the same amount, whether it's in a tall, thin glass or poured into a short, wide glass. And at the age where they get what's called object constancy, which is that the water is really the same amount, it's the same water, no matter what size container it's in, they also get that a girl is really a different thing than a boy, and you can't change back and forth between them. A cat can't become a dog by getting a longer tail or different ears, and a girl can't become a boy by putting on pants, or a boy can't become a girl by wearing a dress and putting a bow in his hair. And when they get that object constancy, it creates a problem for them intellectually and also personally that they have to figure out where they fit in that system. Okay, a longer answer maybe. Yes, and what's your name?
Laurel.
Laurel? Yeah, great. Okay, collective effervescence, you really have to go reread Durkheim because it's a great term, but that is what he's describing in that extract you read from Elementary Forms of Religious Life. So if you've read Elementary Forms of Religious Life, you know all about collective effervescence, but the idea is that in Durkheim's analysis of what creates the experience of something greater than yourself, that you are both part of, but that somehow gives life to you. So collective effervescence is moments of collective excitement that energize you and make you feel part of something larger than yourself, I would say. But it's how it fits into his theory that is, I'm less worried about your defining it. If I use definitions, I always say define and give the significance of. And it's really the significance of part. Where does it fit into his thinking? Why does he have such a concept? Not just so that you can say, oh, I went to a football game and I felt carried away, although that is, you know, I screamed myself hoarse, I was out of my mind. Those are the experiences he's talking about, but it's seeing how it fits into his whole analysis of how people come to experience the divine as real. That's what he's really interested in. More. Oh, indoctrination, sorry. Oh, well, there I was describing what I call the older, more passive versions of socialization, which aren't completely untrue. That is, there are elements of truth in all of them. And so indoctrination is the model that says people learn, children learn especially, but people learn from society by being told. By being told what to do. So indoctrination is sort of a strong word for educational type learning. So this is indoctrination. If I tell you that what you ought to do is, you know, study hard, that's indoctrination. I would say one thing is, if I could find a way to say all people who are successful in life learn early that the brain absorbs things much better if it absorbs them over time. And so they work in a disciplined way in small pieces, something like that. If I could tie it to an identity you wanted to have, you'd be much more likely to do it. Because you actually want to be a successful person, or this is a little bit different, but when I taught at Harvard, one of the things you could do, because all those kids wanted to be, they're just so, pardon me, arrogant. They weren't any smarter than you, but they sure thought they were. And no, and that made it fun to teach in a certain way and kind of bizarre in other ways. But one of the things you could do is say, oh, every educated person should have read all of Marx. I would never actually say that, but. And they would run out. Better jump on it, you know? And it was very powerful because, you know, you really could manipulate that valued identity and get a lot of response. So anyway, that's a little off. Yes, what's your name?
Diane.
Well, maybe everyone heard you because you have a nice, robust voice. That's great. But how in depth do you need to go on all the experiments? I rushed through that at the end of a lecture and didn't really get a chance to describe it in very much depth. But I would say that it would be very valuable to be able to make the general point that if there's a question about how men and women, why men and women systematically behave differently and whether or not that is tied to deep motivational structures or to other styles, skills, and habits, say, there is evidence there among other places. So even if you didn't remember, certainly you don't have to remember that the person who did the studies is named Alice Eagley, although I remember that, but you don't have to. But understanding that some of these motives that are supposed to be really different between women and men, and which show up as different if you do standard type experiments, but that the differences disappear to a large degree and in somewhat different ways for these different things when the social cues that trigger gender identities are removed from the situation. I guess that's how I would summarize that literature. And in all such answers, if you know a little detail that shows you actually heard the lecture and not just the review session, wow, that's good. So, yes, and what's your name? Christine? Christy. Oh, that's a really good question. Do the terms inclusive and extractive apply only to political and economic institutions? So those are, yeah? That's a really good question. So she said, does that apply to other kinds of institutions? First, I would say that's actually a very good question that wouldn't be the kind of thing you need to review for the exam. It's actually a question that goes beyond, in a sense, what you were assigned. But yes, I do think that if you could specify in a clear way how some institutional structures become extractive, and if you read the whole book, Smoglu and Robinson do kind of have a story about that. I mean, they try to explain it. I think they have a harder time trying to explain why some institutions become inclusive, actually. That looks like it's a more fragile, a little harder to explain what perpetuates that. But yes, in fact, there is some historical work that is about attempts to monopolize the sacred in different societies and battles over that monopoly. And the world we live in, meaning the world that inherited Anglo-American religious traditions, that battle over the monopoly of the sacred was really resolved in about the middle of the 17th century in England. But it was a very important part of the English Civil War in the early 1640, so I shouldn't say in the middle, was the question of who had the right to define what's sacred. And if you imagine something where, for example, you can't be buried without a certain ritual, and the church can refuse it to you, that's a source of extraordinary power that can be used for all sorts of, say, rent seeking. And I think in many civilizations in the world, but not in the one that's familiar to us in daily life, that's a really important issue. So, yes, what's your name? John.
Can you go over the difference between an experiment and demonstration?
Can I go over the difference between an experiment and demonstration? I'm eager to. Thank you for asking. Okay, because I know there was some confusion afterwards, and for good reason, I think, which is a demonstration is basically a single event, study, something that convinces you that something extraordinary that you thought couldn't happen, can happen. And so it suggests the need for theoretical development, it suggests the need for more work, but it doesn't start from an explanatory theory that you're testing. That is, it doesn't start from, I think thing A has an influence on thing B. You know, I think penicillin has an influence on recovery from pneumonia, and I'm going to test that by taking a bunch of people who have pneumonia and randomly giving penicillin to half of them and not the other half and seeing whether the ones who get the penicillin do better, because I already have a theory. And the reason it was confusing is because the Milgram experiment was turned into a demonstration because he got such an extraordinary result when he started the experiment. So it started as an experiment to test the effect of national character on obedience to authority. It was a true experiment. He had a theory. He had a theory that national character made a difference, that Germans would be more obedient than Americans, and he was ready to roll. And then he did it in the US, and instead of getting 0.5% who conformed and gave all these shocks, he got 60%. And he was just thrown on his heels. And so it effectively became a demonstration even though it was intended to be an experiment. So an experiment tests the effect of an independent variable on a dependent variable by trying to control other sources of variation. So you do the thing in exact identical way, except you vary the one thing you think is really important. That's, I mean, sometimes you can vary two things if you have a very complex experiment with four conditions. But really, you normally, the classic experiment, you're varying one thing. The problem with the demonstration is that, whoa, you have a whole bunch of things must have happened there that you weren't anticipating, and you have no idea what variable to study in order to find out what was going on. So what I described was the kind of heroic struggle of Milgram then to conduct experiment after experiment, the early ones not very satisfactory. He tried varying the kind of people, men and women different, not really. He tried varying the place he conducted the experiment, Yale versus Bridgeport, Connecticut, not much difference. He then tried varying, very interestingly, the distance between the teacher who has to give the shocks and the learner who has to receive the shocks. And that made a big difference, but led to a kind of vague, not very satisfying theory, I would say. And that's as far as he got in the work you read and the film you saw. And then I argued in lecture that he finally managed to do a series of experiments that really got at the structure of the authority situation. But essentially, a demonstration is theoretically important because it blows your existing theories out of the water. But it's not a true experiment because you don't know what the independent variable is that you should manipulate and what you should control. You just don't know. You don't know what's happening. So that's just, I'll tell you just a funny thing. Indulge myself. Okay, so I went last night, did not, again, break my shoulder, wonderful, to the Giants playoff game. And it was a miserable game. They lost horribly, but since I triumphed by not killing myself, I was very glad. you know, to walk down the same ramp where I had fallen before and not fall, I felt worth it for me. Okay, but what I wanted to say is, you probably don't know this, but in whatever year it was, the Loma Prieta earthquake, well, I should know because her daughter was a baby. Okay, 1989. Loma Prieta earthquake happened during the first game of the World Series when the Giants and the A's were in the World Series, so it was a Bay Bridge series. So I was at home this weekend, and I thought, you know, wouldn't it be weird if both the A's and the Giants won their divisions and then won the league and then ended up in the playoffs and then ended up in the World Series and we had another Bay Bridge World Series and there were another earthquake the first game. And then I thought that would completely, I would have to start over. It would mean that my whole understanding of the nature of the universe was wrong. No, I mean, if that happened, I literally had this kind of little fantasy, and I thought, okay, I'd have to either go and believe in the kind of God who comes into the world and says, I'm going to play a joke on you, and boy, am I powerful enough to do it, or I don't know. So that's the kind of thing I mean, that a demonstration can be extraordinarily powerful because it simply scrambles your existing theories. But then it takes huge, and I would argue heroic, scientific effort to go from that demonstration to the systematic experiments that vary an independent variable under carefully controlled conditions to understand its effect on the outcome of interest on the dependent variable in a way that actually begins to extract the important factors that are shaping whatever it is you're really interested in. So, I don't know, that may have been too long an answer to be useful, but that's my answer. Yes, what's your name?
Sam.
Sam. Yeah, anticipatory socialization is one of these really fascinating ideas. And I think it involves it's again part of my overall argument about why passive models of socialization are inadequate. And the idea is that people sometimes, maybe even more than sometimes, attach the notion of their identities not to who they are, but to who they think they will become. And that means that sometimes semi-unconsciously, they extract from the social world not the social learning that's being thrown at them, but the social learning that's relevant to that thing they expect to become, or they believe they will become, or they know they will become. And so, anticipatory socialization is this idea that you are pulling out of the social world the things that are relevant to either who you expect to be or sometimes to who you want to be. And we really don't understand very well. We understand the expect to be part, which is if you know you're going to college, you will learn more during the summer because every new vocabulary word you hear, instead of closing your ears and thinking, "Yeah, I don't care about that," you'll think, "What? What? That might be a college-relevant word, right?" And so, unlike somebody else listening to that word, you will hear it. And we know systematically from research that students who know they're going to college learn more during the summer before college than students of equal IQ who know they are not going to college. This, I think, is actually one of the strongest arguments for affirmative action. I sometimes say to people, if you give me two 24-year-olds and you send one of them to law school, but you tell her she will never, ever, ever be a lawyer, she will never practice law, she will never be allowed to use those skills, ever, and you take another person and she's 24 and you don't allow her to go to law school, but you tell her that in 3 years she is going to be a practicing lawyer and people are going to, she's going to have a license to practice law and people are going to be coming to her office demanding help with their legal cases, and I ask you, who would know more law in 3 years? And I virtually guarantee you that the one who knew she was going to be a lawyer would learn more law in those 3 years than the person who was stuck in law school with no hope of that ever being relevant to her future. So that is, if you will, the sort of the kernel of anticipatory socialization. I think the part of it we don't understand well, and then I'll stop so you can ask other questions, is why some individuals sort of look up from where they are and even sometimes point at a very distant place. Some of you may be like that, that no one else in your neighborhood, no one else in your family ever thought, I'm going to be a lawyer, I'm going to be a doctor. But somehow you got that idea, and maybe you got it from a little TV program you saw or a snatch of conversation, but you fixated on it. And that can be a huge sort of, some people just remake themselves in ways that are extraordinary. I don't know if you ever want to read it. It's a beautiful book. It's an autobiography by Richard Wright, the African-American novelist called Black Boy. And he grew up in this very poor town in Mississippi. And for reasons that really are not clear, he became just sort of fetishistically focused on the library. And he went back again and again, and he got this aspiration to read every book that had ever been written. And nothing in his background would have predicted that he could have done what he did. There's nothing about his past. And so where did he get that idea that he, not someone else, but he could be this person who eventually became a great novelist? And you just don't, I mean, it's a wonderful book. It's not very long, and it's very beautifully written. But we don't understand processes like that very well. Anyway, that's anticipatory socialization. Yes, and your name? Lynn. Okay. The values versus toolkits debate. Yes, this has to do, remember I said there were these three debates in understandings of how people are shaped socially. And so one of them was the modular versus unitary. And the toolkit versus values debate really has to do with that one. So the question is, do people have a unitary sort of hierarchy of things that matter to them so that they're motivated by a relatively unified set of values? You know, and the most important one is to be, I don't know, an honest person, and then after that to be a good friend, and then after that to bring world peace, and then after that, I mean, literally, and there are studies of this that try to attach some notion of people's values, including what they say, but also there might be other ways to measure them, to how they'll actually behave in a given situation, versus there are ideas that people have multiple things going on. This is the modular argument, and that those multiple things mean that in different situations, they might have a different set of aspirations or hierarchy of things they want, and that maybe what they end up doing is less determined by some kind of very deeply, you know, set values that send them in a kind of unitary direction, and more by what capacities they have in their, what I call toolkits. But the quote toolkit, you can't think of it like somebody sitting there and consciously saying, what tool I use? What would be good to, you know, who should I be today? Which of my style, skills, and habits should I employ in order to get a good job, or in order to make friends with this person, or in order to fall in love with this person? But nonetheless, you could kind of imagine, and this would be the sort of modular cultured, what cultured capacities do you have available, that if someone asked you if you would like to be an upper class woman married to, I'm trying to think, something very blue blood, I don't know, married to one of the, it's too destructive, but anyway, married to one of the Rockefellers. You could ask you if you'd like to do that. Is that somewhere in your values that you'd say, no, I don't believe in that, I don't like money? But you could be a person who says, God, I'd love to be married to one of the Rockefeller sons, I'm imagining a woman here, and, you know, be on the board of every museum and be able to determine whether, what, you know, whether the symphony gets money and be able to travel anywhere and live anywhere. But me, you've got to be kidding. I don't know how to do my hair the way those women do it. I don't know how to make chit-chat the way these upper-class women do. I don't know how to shriek and sound overjoyed to see people and then make tiny bits of, I've actually been in a situation with such people. And, you know, and then, you know, and I'm not named Mitzi or Bitsy or anything like that. So that would be, gee, I just don't have the tools to be that person, and I don't have it at any level. I don't, you know, my hair wouldn't be right. I don't know how to match my purse and my shoes. I don't have thin enough calves. I don't know. I mean, you know, I'm not short enough. I mean, I just couldn't pull it off. I couldn't be that person. And so the question of whether I want to be that person is kind of irrelevant. And that's, I guess, how I'm thinking of it. That one idea is that people have sort of values and goals, and that's the thing that really motivates them, and there's a kind of unified thing. Another would be that we're kind of shaped by what we could do, and whether in our capacities, and that also the idea would be you expand your capacities periodically, which is what I hope you're doing here. So, yes, your name? Vivian. Well, I hope the whole set of, so I can't do that very rapidly since the whole set of lectures was meant to say that some things that are at one level very deep, like your biology, might also not be very enduring in the sense that they can be changed, right? So all the examples I was giving in those lectures were really meant to break up the idea that, you know, unitary, deep, and enduring always go together. So you should both understand why that model is persuasive. That is, maybe that's what I didn't articulate clearly enough, that the classic model of socialization would be that in early childhood, you deeply internalize a set of unitary values and beliefs or something like that, and that because they were internalized early and they're very deep inside you, they are extremely enduring and long-lasting, and they shape everything else, right? And that the deep things, this is why people are always fascinated by gender, because they want to know whether the gender differences they observe are, quote, natural. And I cannot break undergraduates of the habit of thinking that is the most important question. Are they natural? Are they natural? Well, I mean, only in a world where you have no other way of understanding why people are different from each other are you obsessed with the idea that a certain kind of difference might actually be biological. And what I've tried to say is, you know, those differences might exist and they might be just as malleable or just as unlikely to express themselves in certain situations as other things. So it's not that sort of those three might not go together, but the main point I would say of the whole series of lectures was all the ways in which they cannot go together. Yeah. I want to see if there's somebody up there I've been systematically ignoring. No, then, and your name? So what's the point about men and women living in different worlds? There I was trying to say that just as with the Matina Horner study of fear of success, where it turned out men and women weren't necessarily projecting their own deep inner fantasies and anxieties, but they were describing different objective likelihoods. How were things going to work out for a woman in 1970 who was number one in her medical school class? And they were at least imagining that nobody would marry her, that nobody would hire her. I mean, that might have been a pretty good prediction in that day, and that she would have been seen as not a very nice person because she was too successful, right? So I tried to say that in lots of ways that you wouldn't necessarily be able to perceive right away, men and women might actually live in objectively different worlds. Objectively different worlds in the sense that I used the Ron Kessler example about depression, and I said maybe women literally hear many more depressing things than men do. So it's not that they are biologically predisposed to be depressed or that they are inherently psychologically more willing because of their socialization to express their bad emotions honestly. It really might be that structurally they are in a situation where people are more likely to tell them bad things. Their friends are more likely to share painful moments. Their girlfriends are more likely to drag them through every detail of an ugly divorce. They're, you know, and that is, and so I tried to talk about the inequalities in the marriage market and the difference in divorce and maybe a couple of other things that would mean that women and men were responding to real differences. And I don't deny, men and women are really different. They behave differently, not 100%, there's a big overlap in the curves, but nonetheless, you can pretty much predict who's the one who's going to be constantly interrupting the other one when they talk? Probably the woman. Who's the one who's going to be constantly going, while the other person's talking? Probably the girl. And these are things, by the way, those of you who go into business, the women will be trying to suppress that. In a business meeting, you can't sit there going, oh yeah, that reminds me. Oh yeah, the same thing happened to me. Oh yeah. So we don't quite know why men and women have different styles, skills, and habits. But I tried to show that they don't necessarily have different deep motives. Okay, I'm gonna remember to take my